In today's video, we're going to talk about proper dimensioning of your sketches within Fusion 360. Let's get started. How's it going, guys? Welcome back to another Fusion 360 CAD for Newbies tutorial series here on Makers Muse. So what do I mean when I say correct dimensioning of sketches? So sketches are a fundamental part of 3D modeling in Fusion 360. You draw a sketch and then you do something with it. You might extrude it into a 3D object, you might revolve it, or you might sweep it along a path or do various other functions to it. But basically that sketch is the starting point of everything in your design when you're designing parametrically. But when it comes to designing things accurately, you know, with a pair of calipers and measuring things for real world projects, these things, you really need to be careful of how you put in those dimensions, because when you go back to perhaps change things, you want things to update in the way that they should and not explode or update incorrectly and get parts that don't quite work. So in this video, I'm going to go through basically my process of doing good dimensioning, and to stress, it is how I approach it. It may not be a way that you're comfortable with. You might like to do things slightly differently. That's totally cool. It's just how I do it. And what I'm going to show you here isn't really a replacement of a university degree in 3D modeling. It's not intended to be. It's really just to help you think about correct dimensioning for your awesome 3D printing projects using Fusion 360. All right. So let's start with a sketch. I'm going to click sketch, create sketch, and top plane here. So a big part of Fusion 360 is learning the hotkeys. So I'm going to hit R, and that's for rectangle. So I'm just going to draw a rectangle here in space. Now you just would have seen some numbers pop up there briefly. You can actually pump in dimensions as you're drawing shapes in Fusion in the sketch mode, but I'm going to do it afterwards using the dimension tool. So we've got a rectangle here and it's blue, and if I just hit escape there, it doesn't really know what it wants to be in life. It's any size and it's any shape and it's anywhere in your workspace. So when you're dimensioning sketches, everything comes back to a single point, which is called your origin. So the origin of this entire 3D workspace is here. And that is 0, 0, 0, which is 0 in the X, Y, and Z axes. So it's where everything converges into that one point. That is 0, where everything starts, and everything's eventually referenced back to that. And that's how you can lock things in space. Even a assembly of hundreds of components will actually be locked to an origin, or at least via other components locking to each other. It all feeds back to an origin, otherwise things will not know where to sort of lock in space. So we've got this rectangle, and let's say we're designing a plate that's 30 by 40 millimeters. How would you go about dimensioning it? So I'm going to hit D, and the most obvious approach would be to just select a line. So when I hover over on the sketch dimensioning tool, the line highlights, and I can click there and hit 40, enter, and here, and hit 30, and enter, escape. So we've got our little rectangle here, but you notice it's still blue. So the cool thing about the latest version of Fusion is the lines will go black when they're what's known as fully defined. When they're fully locked in space, everything is accounted for in terms of where they should be. But it's blue here, which means if I move this rectangle around, yep, it doesn't know where it wants to be in space. So we need to tell it where it should be by using dimensions to dimension it and reference it to the origin. So again, D for dimension. And let's say we just did this edge here to the origin there. Yeah, 40 sounds good. And maybe this top part here to the origin there. And let's go with 16 or 10. 10's fine. Okay, so our sketch has gone black, and that's fantastic. But this isn't really a good way to dimension a sketch. And the reason is, we've kind of put it in this random place off to the side. Whereas the origin should be used as a tool, and it should be used to reference other things that you're going to build later and help you build those shapes. Because don't forget, our planes are based off the origin. For example, if I turn origin on, you can look down here, we've got, you know, our XY plane, you know, we've got our our XZ plane, YZ plane. These are all the planes that you can sketch on by default. Now you can create construction planes and all these sort of things, which I'll go into in further detail in other videos, but these are what you start with, and it's good to actually use what you start with. So I'm gonna get rid of those dimensions. And instead, let's say I'm drawing something symmetrical. Well, I probably want the origin in the middle of our shape. So how would you do that? Would you start moving our shape here and then going D and then clicking the origin and then clicking the edge there and then selecting 40 minus, you know, divided by 2, 20? Sure, that would start working. That would definitely kind of work. But there's also another feature that's extremely powerful built into Fusion 360, which are constraints. So constraints are ways to lock geometry together. And I'm gonna go into them in their very own video, but to show you briefly how a constraint works, what I'm gonna do is select our origin, click there, shift, select our line there at the bottom of our rectangle, right click, and you notice there we have various constraints that have automatically popped up that we can use. Coincident or midpoint? Midpoint. So what that's done is it's stuck our origin right in the middle of our shape, and no matter what size we make it, for example, 40, let's make it 70. It's always gonna be exactly in the middle, which is very useful for keeping things locked in space. Okay, let me show you another case of dimensioning this rectangle. Let's delete the 40 here and the 30 here. And let's add some fillets. So let's go to sketch and fillet, and let's select these edges here. Let's say we're creating, that looks fine. Let's say we're creating like a lozenge style shape like that with rounded corners. How would you dimension this? So yes, Fusion is clever enough to know that if we have dimensioned it before and then we add fillets, it will leave little points of where the edges of the line were, but it's not very good practice, I would say. You can dimension this pretty much exactly how we did it before. However, instead of clicking just one line like that, we now are gonna go down and click the other line there. 30, you can see what's coming next. This line and this line, 40, like that. But it's still blue. And the clever thing about Fusion is we can actually try to work out why it's blue. What's happened is when I did the fillets, I've lost that constraint down the bottom there. So let's just add another constraint back in, like that, midpoint. So there's our fully constrained shape, but instead of just selecting a single line as our dimension, I've selected between two lines to do a dimension. So dimensioning is actually really quite clever. The tool itself can discern between selecting a line, selecting a point, between a line and a point, between a point and a point, selecting a arc, and working out the dimension, for example, the radius or the diameter of that. Also, we can do angles. So let's say we want to do a little detail off the edge of it. Let's do a line here, and let's do a line like that. Okay, escape. Let's add some angle dimensions. So let's select D, select the line, and let's select another line we want to get the angle off, like this one here. There we go. So let's make that 45. Why not? Let's make it 45. There we go. And similarly, this one, we can actually dimension an angle off as well. We could dimension it off that same horizontal line. We could dimension it off the other line. Let's do that. Let's do 30. So now I've got the angle set, but we can still make it taller. So we need to change the height. And this is where you need to start thinking ahead as to where you want to put your dimensions. So let's say this little party hat, we want it to be, let's say you want to make it about that size, whatever it is. We can dimension it here, 19 millimeters, or we could dimension it down to the origin, 49 millimeters. So which one's better? We've got the same thing. It still knows where how high it is. It doesn't know where it is along the edge of the shape. Let's just define that, for example. Let's select this edge there, and this edge there, 10. All right, everything's constrained. Everything looks good. What if we change the height of our lozenge shape? What if we made that 40? Our hat's gone all weird. So what's happening there is we've dimensioned the hat detail, I'm just going to call it a hat detail, to the origin. So now it has to squish in to accommodate for the lozenge rounded square or rectangle shape getting larger. But that's not what we want. We want it to be the same size all the time. Undo. So in this case, what you would actually want to do is dimension to the top of your shape, like this. 19, totally fine. And if we made our shape 50, there you go. So it expands up, but our little hat detail stays the same. So this is what you need to keep in mind when you're dimensioning things, because you're probably going to do what's called iterative design, where you go back to the drawing board almost and change details of your original sketches. You know, you may have 10, 20 sketches in your actual component, in your actual feature tree, but by keeping in mind how things will scale and adapt, you're going to avoid things breaking and crushing into each other. And one more example would be bolt patterns. So let's say you've got a motor and it's got a certain bolt pattern. Let's just hit circle. So C, let's draw a hole there, hole there, hole there. Okay. And then D, make that one 6, make this one 4, and this one 2. Why not? Okay. So let's say that our bolt pattern is like this. Right? I've already worked out the dimensions and I know exactly where it is. How would I dimension it? So you could dimension, you know, this one to this edge there and the top here. You could dimension this one to here. You could dimension this one with a angled, you know, an angled dimension like that. And I could dimension this one here as well, for example. Things aren't locked in, so what I want to do, I want to do a dimension to the bottom here as well, let's say. Okay. So, once again, so you can see it there, everything's constrained. But again, it's constrained poorly. Because what we want to do, say we want to change the size of our plate. Say we want to make it a little bit smaller. For example, we wanted to make it 35. Watch those holes. They're changed. Our bolt pattern will no longer work because we didn't define them properly in relation to each other. We didn't give them the proper dimensions in relation to each other to adapt when we change other dimensions in the sketch. So that's just to undo those dimensions, and let's have another think about how you might want to do it. So that's our pattern. Therefore, it should lock into itself before we do anything else. So let's go to D and let's make sure this is locked in. Now, this is my personal preference. You may feel otherwise, but I generally try to avoid angled dimensions because they're very hard to lock into space. I try to do dimensions on the X or Y. So I try to do a dimension here, 5, and then I'll do another dimension to work out how long and far away they are in that dimension. So 6. Okay, those are done. Now that we can dimension this one, either off the original hole, or this one, depending on if they're likely to change or not in your design. I don't think these are in my design, so I'll just dimension them here again. 7. And 6. It's fine. These will all be dimensions that you would have gotten using your trusty calipers and written down on your trusty grid paper, by the way. Always write down your drawings, your designs before going into CAD. But what I've done now is if I move this around, you notice they're locked together. Even though they're still blue, the whole pattern can never change. Which means all I need now is to define where it should be on this plate. For example, I can define it to my origin down the bottom here. So I can define that as, 19. And, whatever dimension that you find useful, 5. So even if I make this plate 30 across, or maybe if I make this plate 100 across, the holes are not going to change, our bolt pattern's still going to work, and our motor is still going to bolt into place. I cannot stress enough how important it is to take into consideration the relation of different dimensions within your part, and how that when you change something, it might affect and have a knock-on effect down the line. This can mean if you're adding a 0.5 millimeter tolerance to something, if you've got something that's referencing it and that tolerance bumps it across, you might be putting something out of tolerance. It does take practice, and again, this is really my approach to 3D modeling. I am very analytical. I do like to develop a very detailed sketch that works first time instead of going back with features again and again, but it's just usually how I roll. So thanks for watching, guys. Hope you found this video on Fusion 360 useful in terms of developing good sketches for your 3D modeling projects, because the sketch is the base, it's the bedrock of your 3D modeling project. And through your feature tree, you need good sketches to avoid things breaking and then having to go back and rebuild them. And you know, cause no design's right first time. Let's be honest, you usually need 3 shots or so to get it right. And you don't want to come back that second time round and change something only to find that you can't actually change it properly because things have been referenced to the wrong areas. Also, I wanted to pause this video and say a big thank you to Robert, who via Matter Hackers passed this on to me. So, 3D modeling on software is amazingly powerful, but Robert, thank you so much for sending this to me. For those who have never seen this before, this is a proper vintage measured drawing kit. So back in the days before computers, you would have grid paper and you would be doing what we just saw on the software by hand. This is the original kit that Robert sent to me, and man, thank you so much. I will treasure this and I will definitely look after it. So thank you so much for that, Robert. And for everyone else, that's just a snip, a sort of a sneak peek into the past as to how you would have had to do things previously. Things are a lot easier these days. If you enjoyed this video on Fusion 360 on Makers Muse, guys, hit that subscribe button. Helps us out a huge amount, and look forward to seeing you again very shortly. Catch you later, guys. Bye. In the latter half of the 20th century, a man has sent rockets into deep space. He has placed satellites into orbit. He has actually...